If I show you this picture, what do you see? Of course, there's a lot to see there. If you're actually a movie enthusiast, you might recognize the references that are being made by this group of friends. But there is something much more consistent that unites all these various objects together. If it's not clear enough, let me give you additional clues. Now do you see it? If still not yet, let's look at the same idea, but a more straightforward case. As before, we've got trees, we've got girls, stars, cards. But now you might see that there is something which is not physically present in the illustration, but that is the main object that we are speaking about, the main concept, which is the number two. Two trees, two girls, two stars, two cards, two spades, two hearts. And the number two is actually written there. So back to them. What do we have here that we should see more than girls and flowers and stars? The number seven. I actually even give you seven examples. Before we had four objects, but four is two plus two, or is two times two. So that was really two that was shouting at your face. Here we've got seven, and the point is that even though it's not physically present there, we cannot touch the seven, we cannot touch the star neither, and possibly we shouldn't touch these people. But these are still physical objects that we can capture, we can play with, we can interact with in some way, in some direct way. We cannot do that with the number seven itself. But the point that was first made, I believe, by this important person here at the center of the scene, this is Plato in the school of Athens, as represented by Raphael. And it's an interesting painting, by the way, because Raphael did something which is really modern, which was to make some guest star appearance, some cameo appearance. So you might recognize that Plato is actually very much looking like Da Vinci, because this is the person that Raphael honored to represent Plato, who is there speaking with Aristotle. So this Platonic school came with the very important idea that these objects, these mathematical objects, numbers, they actually belong to some universe, the Platonic universe, which is some sort of conceptual world indeed. But just because it's conceptual doesn't mean that it's any less real than the physical universe where you find stars and girls and flowers. Why? Because these numbers happen to have properties of their own, that we are not making it up. It's for us to decide how to, which symbol to use to represent the number seven. But once we have found this concept seven in the Platonic universe, it has some intrinsic property of its own. For instance, the number seven, we cannot write it as a product of other numbers. The number four we can, is two times two, we say, but seven, we can't do that. That's an important property of this number, of some number, which is their primality. A prime number is a number that doesn't exist as a product of smaller numbers. And the Platonic universe is made of a lot of abstract, important objects. You also know some geometrical objects, like the shape, the circle, the triangle. They are also Platonic objects that must be compared to their approximation in the real world. Compare a circle in the Platonic universe with its perfect distance from the center for all points, and there is no width for the circumference. Compare that with the circle that we find on the sand, or if we look at physical objects. This is just an approximation. But somehow they are both related, and it's one of the great mystery of science, is what is the connection between this Platonic universe with its own rules and the physical universe with its other rules, the rules of physics and the rule of mathematics. And somehow they are connected. It's a great mystery of the universe. So in our exploration of the Platonic universe, we'll start with numbers, because these are the objects with which we are the most familiar with, to start with. Yeah, we all have seen this number, one and one, and we can make things like this. Yeah, everybody knows that. That's actually a very nice equation to start any course of mathematics with. And we can iterate the process. So if I add 1 to the previous quantity, this is 1 plus 1 plus 1, 1 plus 2, and this is 3. And of course, this is very trivial, but it already brings us to some sophisticated notion, because we are starting to discover things. And one first discovery is this concept of repeated addition, which is that of multiplication. So if I add 1 to itself 8 times, A being the number of times that I'm doing this operation, I'm using a letter to mean that it could be anything. It could be 3 times as above, or it could be 17 or 7 million times. Yeah? So that's A times 1. We can do this on A itself, because A is a number. So I can add A to itself, let's just say, N times this time. And that gives me N times A. In mathematics, actually, if we deal with letters, we wouldn't put this sign here. We would write directly NA. And we would use this notation rather than others like NA or things like this, which some people like to use, but it might be confusing because we like to reserve these other notations for other operations. We shall actually see an example in a little while. And bringing the problem in this form, to look again at this operation with which you are all familiar with anew, we can indeed see how this Platonic universe has properties that we can both understand and discover. Let us write this a plus a added to itself n times in a full form, where now I'm breaking each line, the first a, e, I'm breaking it as follows. And I'm putting the second a, so I'm adding 1 to itself a times, and I'm doing this n times. So here I've got a times, and here I've got n times. So writing this n times a in this form, we actually discovered the first very important property of multiplication, which will turn out to be crucial for a lot of things in physics, which is the property of commutation. Commutation. Said otherwise, the multiplication is commutative. What does it mean? It means that a n is equal to a n a. The order in which we are making the product doesn't matter. As you can check, as you know, 2 times 3 is 3 times 2, namely 6. If this is not clear with this table of 1, well, let's look at it with, let's say, a box of apples, for instance. It doesn't matter if you count the box, the number of apples from the side of the box or from the other side of the box. You can rotate the box, there is the same number of apples, of course. So this is a geometrical interpretation of this property of commutativity. And in physics, again, we will find that commutativity is really important because not all objects, not all mathematical objects are commutative. Those which are not, we will see that it means that the order in which we apply the physical process to which they correspond matters, and it will turn out to be really important, for instance, in quantum mechanics. But this is for later, and let's stay with numbers for a little while. And to illustrate this concept, this idea, this notion that the Platonic universe is really real, instead of looking at so trivial and familiar examples, which might blur the idea because it's so obvious that you might not see the underlying message. You can maybe be distracted by the property itself, which is simple. You all know that multiplication is commutative. So instead of looking at these familiar simple things, let's look on the opposite of something which is highly sophisticated and not familiar at all. Namely, this theorem, which is called the Erdős-Zemeredy theorem, and that relates addition to multiplication. So it actually tells us something about the process, the two elementary or fundamental process that we can do with numbers, which is to add them or to multiply them. So for this, I need to define another important mathematical notion, which is the concept of set. So a set is a collection, it's written like this, of objects, of mathematical objects, of numbers in our case. So we've got one set here, the set of the first number 1, 2, 3. But not to be too specific, I'm going to take letters and n of them. So I've got n objects in my set, which are a1 and an. And they're all different. If a1 is 2 and a2 is 2, then these two things kind of cancel each other to become the 1, 2. Yeah? We don't have a set which is like this, 2, 2. This is actually the set which has the number 2 inside. So we've got n different numbers in our set A, and we've got another set B, which is defined with this time m numbers in this type. Now we can do two things with this set. We can define the addition of the set. So there is no reason why this would be a priori defined. This is us who decide to define addition of sets in this way. That's the definition. I define the so-called sum set of A and B by making all the possible additions of all A that belongs to the set A. This notation here that looks like the euro symbol is to mean that the element A belongs to the set A. And to all the A of A, I add all the B's of B. I'm not saying small a, big A, small b, big B, because this should be obvious from context. That's the sum set. And similarly, we are going to define the product of set. And for this one, we are going to use this notation, not the times that we use for something else we've said, but this dot. And this is similarly defined. This is all the possible product of all the elements of A and all the elements of B. Now, what the Erdős-Zemléky theorem states is the following. That if you look at the cardinality of a set, which we write like this, another notation is like this, yeah, the cardinality, which is the size of the set, in the sense of how many elements it has. So my first set, 1, 2, 3, has cardinality 3. So we put this absolute value because it gives us this notion of distance. We'll use this notion of absolute value to mean distance. So if we look at how many elements we've got in the sum set or in the product set, A plus A or A times A, one of them will be much larger than the other, and the maximum is bounded by the cardinality of the set itself. And this Erdős-Zemléky theorem is actually something that has been postulated by them. They said that epsilon could be made equal to 1. And mathematicians have tried to demonstrate that. And you can try to look at it from an empirical point of view, which means that you would take a computer and take two sets, A and B. Or actually, there is only one set involved there. So you take a set of numbers, you choose the numbers, you put how many as you want there. And they don't have to have any structures. They can be continuous or taken randomly. And you look at the sum set and the product set, and you look at how many distinct combinations you form. Because if you've got 1 and 4, that makes 5. And if you've got 0 and 5, that would also make you 5. And the same with the product. Yeah, if you've got 2 and 10, and 5 and 4, then the two products will make you 20. So one set, it is absurd. That's almost like an empirical finding. I don't know how Erdős and Zemléky saw that. But there is a connection between addition and multiplication that one set will have much more elements than the others. And it tends to show that a list of numbers, they can behave like arithmetic progression, which means that lists that tend to add together, or geometric progression, which means that they like to multiply together. And the conjecture that the epsilon could be made to 1, and nobody got the proof that it's indeed the case, that it is bounded by the square of the cardinality of A. What people have managed to prove so far, unless there's been new development in the field, is this quantity that I'll let you evaluate at close it is to 1. And now, what good is it for to look at that? I mean, it's one of these particular examples that doesn't have obvious applications or maybe even meaning. But it indeed tells us that there is some structure, some property of this Platonic universe, which is for us to discover and play with. What it shows us here, if you look at it into more detail, is that addition and multiplication, they're sort of related or connected in some weird way, which is a bit like of repulsion. Either numbers like to add like they add each other, or they add like they multiply each other. Any list of numbers, whatever list you look at, it's kind of mysterious, right? It tells us about the structure of this Platonic universe, which is for us to investigate. So that's a highly sophisticated example. I don't think you will need or even meet this property again in your life. But that's one of the kind of things that mathematicians like to look at. Now we are going to look at something which is actually more important and useful for us, which is another property, fundamental property of numbers, which is related to their primality. So-called prime numbers is numbers like 7 or 13 or 17, which cannot be written as product of smaller numbers, like 4, for instance. We said already that 4 is 2 times 2. If I take 6, this is 2 times 3, so on and so forth. So these are primes, and these are not primes. Now there is a very important conjecture, which is called Goldbach conjecture, which says that even numbers, every even number, so what is an even number? It's a number which is a multiple of 2. That's an even number. A number which is not even is called odd, and then it's something which is of this type. This is not a product of 2. So every even number, according to Goldbach conjecture, can be written as the sum of two prime numbers. And this we don't know if it's true. We just observed, and you can check with the computer, but the computer can only check it for a finite number of cases, and there's an infinite number of numbers, if you allow me the pun. It seems to be true. It's been checked to very high cases. But nobody could prove it. And it looks like a very simple statement, but it's one that is actually very difficult to actually demonstrate. It might not be true after all. It might just be that by coincidences, it remains true, it stays true, till a very large number. But in mathematics, something which is true has to be perfectly true. There is no approximation, it has to be always true. So a computer cannot prove it because it cannot check all the cases, but it could disprove it by finding a counterexample. If you find one even number which cannot be written as the sum of two prime, and this is easy to check if this number exists, because once we found it, we have exhausted all the possible cases because only smaller numbers can add to a bigger number, then that would disprove Goldbach conjecture. It's possibly true, or it could be even something more mysterious that I will leave for another lecture, which is that it's not decidable. Another example with prime numbers. If you take so-called twin primes, what is a twin primes? It's two numbers, two consecutive numbers that are separated, of which you have kicked out the even number which is in between. Because all primes number, except 2 itself, because 2 is prime, but except 2, all primes number are odd, as you can easily show, because by definition, it's trivial, it's obvious. This number here is a multiple of 2, by definition, so it's not prime. So you have to kick this even number, and then if these two numbers odd, that's it, on both sides of this even number, are themselves primes, we call that twin prime. And there is another conjecture, which is that there is an infinite number of twin primes. But again, we don't know if it's true. It's something that the computer can look for, but it will never prove. And you might maybe find a clever proof or highly sophisticated proof that shows that. Then you become instantly famous. So there are lots of things that we don't know and that are left for us to investigate, or maybe even other properties that we have to postulate. So it's really a wordplay, a universe, which has this structure. We don't make up the rules, we discover it. We play with the rules that are given and we make progress. Or not. A lot of people spend a lot of time, might say waste a lot of time, trying to prove things without success. And all that, there are a lot of things that we don't know, there is also a lot of things that we know. Mathematicians have made good jobs, very clever people, in a course of a lot of time, have established a lot of properties of this Platonic universe. One example, for instance, is that there is an infinite number of primes, which is something that has been proven early on by one of the group of the gang here, the one on the side, Euclid. So once we have established properties with numbers, and so far we dealt with so-called integers or natural numbers, 1, 2, 3, so the easiest number, the one that you start with to count. And this we will call n, by the way, that's the set of natural numbers or positive integers. So we can extend the collection of objects and discover new objects that are maybe more interesting, more rich, more complex, and keep finding new things or extending our horizon. It's like discovering new territory in the Platonic universe. And the next extension, the next thing to do, is to go to the so-called Z set, which is the same set as the integers, but to which we add the negative numbers. So we also have 0, by the way, here, shouldn't forget it. Conway would be very upset with me. So we've got the negative number. And negative numbers, they are very familiar for us nowadays because we all have the bank account and it's very easy to go negative in the bank account. Negative numbers, they appear in connection with the addition. Actually, we define the subtraction in this way. A minus B is not a new operation. Is just adding with in Z. Z, it comes from Zahlen in German, which means to count. So that's what defines subtraction. Subtraction is not something different from addition. It's just using different mathematical objects. So the point is that for every integer number A, we can find another number that I will call B for now, such that A plus B is equal to this very special element, 0, the one that I didn't put initially. So if this is the case, this number B, we call it minus A. And the same concept can be applied to multiplication, in which case it is not 0, which is a special or interesting number, but this is 1. 0 is special for addition, 1 is special for multiplication. So if I take a number, I will call P, that I add to itself Q times. If this number is equal to 1 when it's added to itself Q times, we call this number 1 over q. You can check that 1 over q plus 1 over q added to itself q times gives 1. If it doesn't give 1, but it gives another full number, integer number, which is p, then this number we'll call p over q. And the collections of all numbers that are the ratio of two integers, the set of all P and Q with P and Q belonging to Z, to the Zahlen set, this we call the set of rational numbers. Rational, and we give it the letters Q. That's an important concept, this rational numbers. In next lecture, we will see the algebra, which means that the rules of additions of between rationals, and it will give us a closer understanding of what it means to make the ratio of two integers. But so far, this is this. It's P over Q is a number that added to itself Q times, give us the full number P. And these numbers are really good because with this we can approximate any real number that we find in the physical universe. So we can think for numbers in the physical universe of something like the distance. So if you take, for instance, something which is 1 upwards and it goes 1 eastwards, then you can be interested in this distance over there. So you know from Pythagoras' theorem that this is the distance square root of 2. So that's just notation for this distance so far. It's how long does it take to go from this point to this point in a straight line, rather than following the path which is down and on the right. So it was one of the great commotion of science, one of the great tragedy of mathematics, that this number, square root of 2, it cannot be written as the ratio of two integers. However big you take these integers P and Q, you can approximate it. Yeah, you can take the number as I show you there. For P, you can take that's 141,421. And for the denominator Q, you can take 100,000. So if you take this combination, you can check by taking the square of this. That's the definition of the square root, by the way, is the number that if we multiply it by itself, it gives the radicand, it gives 2. So if I multiply this thing by itself, the square, make the calculation, we'll see that it's very close to 2. It's 1.9999, and then at some point you start to deviate. You see that here, I take the mouse, you see that at this stage, the fact that we take P and Q as this particular case, then it starts to become different from 2. But up to the sixth decimal, this is correct, because if I add an infinite sequence of 9, well, this is essentially a 2. We will see this fact, which might be a bit surprising at this stage when we discuss the concept of limit. So we could take another approximation, which is better. If we take these two numbers for P and Q, I'm not reading them, you got them there. Please check the algebra yourself. You see that it's much closer to 2 than the previous case, because now we start to deviate from the ideal 2 at this decimal. So we could make the mistake as small as possible, but we could never make it perfect, which is something that has been discovered by someone we just saw in our school of Athens. This person here, a friend of this person, the person represented here is Pythagoras, who is discussing with Archimedes. You see Archimedes demonstrating his principle by the foot of Pythagoras. But Pythagoras himself, or someone, some friends of him of the school of Pythagoras, the Pythagorean school, they happened to be on the boat when this happened, so the story says, and someone who was called Epasus came to them and said, people, or guys, I don't know, they were addressing in ancient Greek, he told them, I found something incredible. The square root of 2, this distance, it doesn't exist. It doesn't exist in the sense that it's not a rational number. It cannot be written as the ratio of two integers, because for the Greeks, it was really important. They had this theory of harmonies how the things fit together, that every quantity could be expressed as the ratio of two integers. But Epasus demonstrated it's not the case. And the proof is actually straightforward. This is maybe what he told them on the boat. He told them, okay, let's assume that I found P and Q, which ratio is equal to the square root of 2. Now, something which is important to understand this proof, and that will be practical as well for us, is that the same number, the same quantity, same distance, if you want to think in terms of something concrete, can be written in different ways. There is various ways to write the same number. So let me give you an example. If I take, 5 divided by 3, this we can also write as 10 divided by 6, for instance. So it's two different fractions, two different choice of P and Q, because 5 is not equal to 10, and 3 is not equal to 6, but they are both equal to the same number, which is 1.6 and infinite stream of 6. But there is a way, so various representation, but there is a way to find the unique representation. This one is a unique representation. How do we find this? It's requires this concept that we introduced previously of prime numbers. We have to write all the numbers in terms of the product of prime numbers. That's what makes prime number so important and so particular, because that allows us to do this kind of things. 10 I can write as 2 times 5, both 2 and 5 are primes, and 6 similarly is 2 times 3. And then we can simplify, because we've got 2 which is both in the numerator and in the denominator, so I can cancel it like this, in which case I'm left with 5 3, which is the thing that we started with. So this one in yellow there is the unique representation. We use in mathematics the so-called GCD, which is the abbreviation for greatest common divisor, for two numbers A and B, so that's another number C. It's the GCD is the term of primes, is the product of prime numbers that have in common. So the GCD of 10 and 6 would be 2, because they have 2 in common. So Epasus on the boat, I don't think he was using this term of GCD, but he used P and Q in their reduced form, which means that he had simplified the GCD already. And his argument of Epasus was as follows. Let's assume that I can write square root of 2 in this form of the ratio of two numbers P and Q. So if I take the square of this, I multiply P and Q by itself. I do this on the left hand side and on the right hand side. So I've got square root of 2, by definition squared is equal to 2. What I find is that P squared is equal to 2Q squared. Whatever P and Q satisfy this condition that their ratio gives square root of 2, will have this property. Which means, if you remember the definition, it means that P squared is an even number. That's the definition of even, is that you are multiple of 2. Now, we are going to demonstrate that we will need that later, and that's maybe the difficulty of mathematics. That's what you need to be used to, is that it requires a lot of different elements. It's a big puzzle and you need to put a lot of different pieces together. So keep that in mind, that P squared is even. We are going to demonstrate now that I will use a different letter C, not to mix with P and Q, that if a square is even, so if C squared is even, then that means that C itself is even. So far we didn't demonstrate it, I'm just stating it, we are going to demonstrate it and use it for our proof of Epasus. So let's assume that C is odd. What does it mean that C is odd? It means that I can write it in this form, 2k plus 1 is not even, because I add 1 to the multiple of 2. This cannot be divided by 2. If you divide by 2, you will be left with 1 half, 0.5, which means it's not an integer, it's not an entire number. So if C is odd, let's look at what happens with the square. I compute, so I'm going to go slowly because we didn't go through the algebra of these things in details yet. We'll do that next lecture. So you remember you have to do this, you have to look at all the distribution, we have to look at all these possible combinations. So the first one here is 4k squared, then these arrows that I should use with different color maybe. So I did this one, and I'm going to look at this one. I'm going slower than you certainly need, yeah, but you are welcome to check. So that's 4k, the orange, because I've got 2k plus 2k, and then we are left with the final one, for which I will take this pink color. This is equal to 1. And what do we find here? That this is also an even number. Why? Because this I can write it as 2. I need to factorize, so I'm left with 2k squared plus 2k, isn't it, plus 1. Okay, this is equal to the thing of before, and this is a number, this I could call kappa, yeah, and if I wanted to be elegant, I would say where kappa is, I would factorize what I can factorize. Kappa is 2k k plus 1. Please check, but I think it's correct. So kappa is a number, so it's equal to 2 kappa plus 1, and this means that c squared here, c squared is odd, yeah, because it's twice a number plus 1. That's an odd number. So if C is odd, then C squared is odd. That means then, the fact that if C is odd, C squared is odd, it means that my initial statement, which is there, now is demonstrated. Because indeed, if C squared being even, I take C squared being even, if c would be odd, c squared wouldn't be even, it would be odd. That's what we showed before. So c squared being even shows that c is even. So we demonstrated that. Okay, so I can assume this thing demonstrated and come back. So we got p squared is even, which means I will use this symbol of the arrow. According to this highlighted in red property, it means that p is even. So if p is even, it means that by definition is twice the number, twice another number that I can call r. That's the definition of p being even. So I can substitute it there. This is equal to this quantity, yeah, where I have here said that p is even. So it exists as the twice the another number. And then if we look at this new equation that I took there, so I'm going to copy it and carry on there. As I told you, it's like a big puzzle, mathematics. So let's carry on with this thing. That's what Epasius did on the boat. Yeah, and you can imagine all the friend asking him, come on, what's your point? What do you want to show us? Okay, let's go. So that's 2 equal 4r squared divided by q squared. I expanded the product. I can bring the q squared on this side. I can simplify by 2. So I've got q squared equal 2r squared. And this q squared equal 2r squared, we can compare it with our starting point, which was there. Let's copy this one as well. Compare these two quantities. Getting rid of the extra bits. We've got the same, but now this is q, which is the denominator that has the property of being twice the square of something else, which was our starting point with the numerator. So if we apply the same logic, the same reasoning to this thing, we will arrive at the conclusion that q is even. We just have to repeat exactly the same step as I did. You can do it. But if p and q are both even, it means that the GCD of p and q is at least 2, must be 2. They have 2, which is as a common factor, 2 times something else, possibly. But that is precisely what Epasius didn't want to start with. He started with the reduced form, where he had simplified by the GCD. P and q have GCD 1. He took the unique, irreducible representation of this fraction. But this shows, because of this loop of taking the square of odd and even numbers having these properties of the Platonic universe, it was not in the end of the Greek people on the boat. It escaped them. It was the inescapable conclusion of this that square root of 2 cannot be written as the ratio of two integers. You cannot divide two integers, take their square, and it will be exactly 2. It can be arbitrarily close as you want by taking p and q big enough, but we'll never get exactly 2. And it was a tragedy, because for these people it means that this distance in Pythagoras' theorem, this precise distance here, it doesn't exist in this form. They disliked so much the result that what do you think they did? Well, they killed Epasius, they threw him over the board. Yeah. And they tried to keep it a secret. But it's impossible to keep a secret because like this, because eventually someone will come and repeat the proof, or maybe find an alternative. So whenever you find something, you shouldn't keep it secret. We'll find repeatedly in the history of science that many people try to keep their discovery secret. This is a mistake, because someone will take it from you anyway. It's like if you discover a nice spot in the countryside, it's better to share it with your friends and to let other people know, rather than to keep it secret in the hope that nobody will come and bother you when you go there, because eventually someone will find it anyway. So it's better to be open and share things, because like this it becomes yours, so to speak. So these Pythagorean people, instead of punishing Epasius in this way, what they should have done, and this is what mathematicians later did following them, is to enlarge this collection of numbers. So from the set of rational numbers, which is the set that we can write as p and q, with p and q being integers or sine integers, which means I use the Zahlen set. But it's not complete, it's missing something. There are some holes or some gaps in the thing that's missing, for instance, square root of 2. So we create another set, which we use the letter R for it, because this is the set of real numbers. So these are all the numbers that include Q plus something else. So there is no name for it, as far as I know, but these are the things like square root of 2, square root of 3. You can actually show that the square root of any n, which is not a square itself, is an irrational number. Irrational, it means something that cannot be written in the form P over Q. Yeah, so x, if x belongs to I, then x is different than P over Q, or there doesn't exist P and Q, so that x can be written as the ratio of them. So that's a collection of numbers so far, of mathematical objects. N, the set of integers, Z, the set of signed integers, Q, the set of rationals, and R, the set of real numbers. So what we are going to do in the rest of the course is essentially two things. One is to extend our collection of mathematical objects, which they don't have to be numbers. Actually, we don't even have the full set of numbers there. We will introduce a new class of numbers that are called complex numbers, that happen to be possibly the most important numbers for physicists, which are not present in this list, and they behave like numbers. But there are other types of objects, like tables of numbers, or matrices, or functions, or even different types of mathematical objects, even geometrical shapes, for instance, are objects in their own right, and they have their properties. And this is the second objective of the course, is to look at the way that members or elements of the Platonic universe behave, to try to look at the laws or properties behavior of or how things happen in this Platonic universe. Because as physicists, you are interested to describe the physical universe, to describe how an electron interacts with light. Well, in mathematics, we are interested to know how numbers behave or comport with each other. And it's indeed highly rewarding because they behave in funny, strange ways. For instance, one property, which we will also look at in detail, is that there are much more real numbers than there are rational numbers. And it might be obvious or not yet, I don't know how you feel about that, but you can appreciate the nature of this paradox, or this paradox, this counterintuitive statement, if I tell you now that there is the same number, or the same quantity, some cardinality, that would be the exact term. Remember, cardinality is the size of a set, is the number of elements that there is in it. And of course, there is an infinite number of integers, infinite number of signed integers, infinite number of rationals. So we can deal with infinities as well, infinite sets. And the statement is that the cardinality of rational and integer is the same. There are as many integers than there are rational numbers. But there are much more real numbers than there are rational numbers. And this is because of the irrational. There are much more irrationals than there are rational. And this is something interesting, really deep, and it's linked to the nature of continuum and discrete infinity. So we'll see that when we look at our lectures about infinities. I might conclude this lecture by telling you as well that set theory is really important for mathematics. So we started at numbers, and we will progress now onward towards more complicated things. But there is another approach, which is to go at the more fundamental level. Is there something more fundamental than numbers? And something which is more fundamental than number is this concept of set, precisely. And it all starts with the empty set. Empty set is the set that has nothing. So there is nothing inside, right? And then you can look a set which has, as the member, as the element, the empty set. So far, I only have this concept or notion of set, and I'm not using anything else than the empty set. That's like the vacuum or nothing. And only with this, I can define a new set to which I can give a number. I will call it 1. And this is how we define number in some axiomatic system, which is called the Frankel-Zermelo system. The number 1 is defined as the set which has, as its element, the empty set. And then you can define the set which has element 1 and the empty set. So this is the empty set, and this set which has the empty set. And this we call 2. And you can, like this, iterate, find 3, so on and so forth. 3 is 2 and the empty set. So you can expand and you get this thing. And that's how you define numbers. And again, it might look like it's a moot point, but for mathematicians, it is important to pose questions like, is all this consistent, or how fundamental can we go? Because we are discovering properties, but these properties maybe they rely or they involve a concept which in itself is flawed, is not consistent, is broken. So we have to start as clean and as fundamental as possible. So for the integers, it might not look such a big deal, but to define real numbers, actually, I think this is the concept of Dedekind-Kutz. I mean, I forget myself a bit, my number theory and my set theory. But in pure mathematics, in abstract mathematics, it turns out to be really important. So we will not need to go into the most abstract, purest aspect, most fundamental parts of math. Actually, as physicists, the most useful, most recurrent types of math we use is highly applied, is things like derivative or looking at calculus, these kind of things. But because theoretical physics or modern physics or contemporary physics is actually delving so much into the strange or deep connections between the Platonic and the physical universe, these questions start to make sense for a physicist as well. We need to worry about some of these aspects of really abstract and pure math. Actually, I spoke about the elementary process of addition and multiplication of numbers. These are particular cases of what mathematicians call the structures of groups. A group is a set. Again, everything is a set, so it's a collection of elements, of objects, which don't have to be numbers, but they are elements that behave according to some rules. And the rules could be, for instance, what we call multiplication. But it's not like multiplication of number. It's just something that behaves like multiplication. And in a group, there is this axiom that every element has its own inverse. And you see that it's kind of subtle because it's highly abstract in the sense that if you apply these group structures to the numbers, to the integers with addition as the operation for the set, then the inverse is actually the opposite, right? And I'll be very upset in the course, in the class, if you call minus 3 the inverse of 3, because the inverse of 3 is 1 over 3. It's not minus 3, so there is a confusion. There is a confusion if we are already at the high level of math. If you are the most abstract, most fundamental, most pure level of math, the inverse of 3 is indeed minus 3, because you are looking at the group structure of this thing. And this is abstract math indeed, because the mathematician is interested in classification of the groups, in finding how many different groups there are they are related one to the others. And this is not something that would interest normally the physicist, until you realize that you need that as well. You need this group structure, this concept of group, to describe fundamental things like particles or quarks. Gell-Mann, for instance, one of our Nobel Prizes in physics, had to discover himself all this group theory that was well known from pure mathematicians for a long time, when he was trying to describe the quark or the structure of the nucleus or the atom at the most fundamental level. And groups are related, for instance, because I told you the elements don't have to be numbers, they can be abstract things like, for instance, symmetries or rotations or property of geometrical property transformation of the space. And then we need to look at the group theory in the context of physics. But group theory is really abstract math. So all the time, you see, as physicists, we will have to be able to juggle between very concrete applied math, as well as sometimes have a peek at the kind of abstract and pure math that the mathematicians are doing and developing. That's the beauty of our fields. As I like to say often, physicists are the ducks of the animal kingdom. They have to know how to do a bit of everything. Like the duck, they need to be able to fly, to swim, or to walk, depending on what they have to do. Again, being able to do everything, it means that they don't particularly do any of these things really well. Oh, you would all agree with me that the duck is not gracious in anything that he does. But it's certainly highly rewarding that you are able to play or interact with the three fundamental elements of motion. And that's how we regard ourselves as physicists. We are the duck of science. And this being said, I will close this chapter with our Athenian school and look forward to look with you next lecture, the first properties, the first manipulation of this number that we start to accumulate now, n, z, q, and r, and this brings forward the concept of algebra, the rules that tells us how to manipulate objects, mathematical objects of the Platonic universe.